So what we do say we do now is interactive storytelling. We do that through live performance, we do it using content, we also work digitally with apps, we work online, and also in social. We essentially bring stories and characters to life. And when you hear a lot in the industry about brand storytelling, we actually take the word storytelling literally, create fiction, and apply it to brand values to communicate that. This is who we are. Three directors, Beloved, Isabel, who is not here, our creative director, an ex-performer of 15 years stage experience, the showgirl, who you'll be hearing from shortly, literally creature in the corner. Natalie will be introducing herself in quite an unusual way in a couple of minutes. And the nerd, that's me. My interest began, I've worked in marketing for nearly 10 years now, and I'm fascinated by interactions and whether that's through performance or in many cases technology, and how we use technology to apply stories and fiction and narrative is a big part of why we're a very different company than we were 2 years ago. These are the sorts of people we work with, directors, writers, performers, you can read, so I'm sure the rest of that will become clear, but what they all have in common is they're storytellers. What's that, sir? they're all storytellers, and as creatives, and I think we have predominantly creative people in this room, so are you. It's all of our jobs to tell stories, whether it's a very simple story, whether it's writing a novel. It's the key, it's the core of what we all do, and it's you're building narrative and connecting to people is at the heart of any form of creativity. I'm going to show a quick video. It's 1.5 minutes long. It's just some examples of our work over the last year and a half. Hopefully it'll give you a bit of an idea of how we work. It was quite hastily edited last week, so I don't have any words on it yet, so if anyone has any questions about what it is they're actually looking at, feel free to please come and speak to me afterwards. But Natalie, if you could hit play, please. See there, there's quite a wide application of the sort of things we're going to be talking about. You see there, we've worked at festivals, we've worked in TV. Some clip there was actually, we actually artistically directed the album cover for Mumford & Sons' most recent album, Babel. On there you saw apps, which I'll talk about a bit later on, but also, of course, at the core of a lot of what we do is straight up live performance, immersive theatre, storytelling, where the audience become the hero, and the audience become what drives the narrative forward. These are something people will be working with. I won't focus too long on it because it's boring. But we do have a mission statement. We want to get the world playing. The importance of play, of reaching out and interacting with the world around you, not ignoring what's going on in the world, but being inquisitive about it, being adventurous, being experimental, about listening to what the child inside you says and just acting on those impulses that we've lost as we grow older. We want to give a small example of playing now. It is extremely early, I'm very much aware. So to wake you up a little bit, I'm going to introduce you to our Nathalie, who is one of our two creative directors.
Hi.
Hello, welcome.
I'd like to invite you all actually to stand up for a moment. And Adam has been as well. Oh, yes.
Who's here?
Literally yawning, imagine a big mouth, all these mouths.
elbows, the wrists, fingers. Just roll your fingers like this. Shake them out. You probably use your hands a lot. Try people, I'm guessing you might be artists. You shake it out. Bring energy into the palms of the hands. You can activate that. I know you can activate that anytime you want, because you're all creative people. Bringing that like a little magic ball into the palms of our hands. Very good. Improvising at the back here. Reaching up. And now bring focus to the nape of the neck. Some energy there, the back of it. Yeah, just like if you feel like you need to give it a bit of a rub. Basically, this is just exploring whatever your body needs to do today in order to just say hello and wake up. How are we feeling?
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you feeling sparkly? A lot. Woo! That will sound good. Eyes bright. Oh yes, this is such a great space. It's got a great crew. I'm gonna just back out now. Thanks, take a seat. Well done.
Answering a question that we get asked a lot. So who the hell is Reuben? You just met him. He's the little kid. He's the little kid I mentioned before, the one inside all of us. And what we try and do as a company is explore what it is that he feels. It's, like I said, daring, exploring, doing strange things, stepping outside of our comfort zone, making a room full of strangers stand up and wiggle.
And have the best time.
So that's kind of at the core of an ethos for us. But we've been asked to talk today about crossing over. And in terms of how we cross over and what we cross over with, we find ourselves in a unique space that I think a lot of creative people find themselves in at some time or another, which is at the center of commerce, art, and entertainment. It's a very dicey landscape. I've actually produced a very technical document that explains where the sweet spot that we tried to find, the search for the good shit, which sits between the three of them. So I'll get into this later on, but each of these different areas that we have to address every time we begin a new project, each of these serves a different master. It might be the client, it might be the audience, it may be yourself, and it's about operating as a creative business, but also staying sane as creatives, where I think the difficulty and the challenge in effectively crossing over comes from. So if you think about what each of these things represent, commerce is very much a data-driven exercise, a data-driven industry, but what is data? Data is absolutely worthless by itself. It's worthless without context. What gives data context? In many cases, are algorithms, software, computer programs, but actually it's the human brain, it's emotion, it's knowledge. So what does entertainment do to data? It tells you something. It tells you what data means. It tells you what it represents. It may make you happy, it may make you sad, but what it won't necessarily do is make you feel complex emotions, because what art does is introduce imagination to entertainment. So art is something that makes you feel, and that is where computers cannot help us. A computer can tell you through voice recognition software what you just said. It can't tell if you're being sarcastic, it can't tell if you're in love, it can't tell you if you're about to cry. That's what art and entertainment do to data that makes storytelling so effective. And storytelling is what we use to connect those three things. Running through everything, what does narrative do? It gives context to the world around us. The world around us is data. We interpret it through telling stories. It's why people painted on walls when we were cavemen. It inspires, it engages, but it also promotes learning, understanding, and therefore memory. So if I know that we have quite a few marketers in the room, what that means is effective recall. It makes you feel a certain way and you remember how you felt when you experienced a piece of narrative. That's why we work a lot for marketers, not exclusively, but predominantly. It's because you can forge an emotional connection that isn't about exploiting a trend. It's literally about making someone just feel happiness or feel joy or feel excited. Or sometimes it may be that you want them to feel sad or afraid. It's these emotions that you can use to communicate a message effectively. The improvisation of life was obviously a slide that I forgot to put in.
The improvisation of life is actually something that Natalie will tell you about because it's what Natalie deals with every day. But again, our mission statement is you want to get the world playing. The improvisation of life is a mantra about that we try and obey every day about how we work. So I'm just going to hand over to Natalie. Yeah, so I'm going to hand over to Natalie briefly. Don't worry, you can all stay sitting.
Yeah, so our improvisation of life is scrawled on our wall in our office. And the first rule for us is play. And basically because play is fun and it just opens you up to all possibilities of creativity and ideas and being in the moment and not judging what's coming out. It's play, it's fun, it's creative. And we do jump around a lot and shake things out in the process. Letting yourself fail is a really interesting one. You have to throw ideas into the pot, whether it's right or wrong, it doesn't matter. But one idea can trigger something else and then you're off. So I'm sure you deal with that on a daily basis yourselves. In life in general, it's like being okay with failure over and over again. It's like you're always going to come up trumps at some point. So never be scared of failing and just put those ideas into the pot and make that casserole. So listening. It's not enough just to hear in order to respond, but listening so that you, with a willingness to change. So in our rehearsal process, for example, we devise, we improvise. And if you already have something in your mind that you have the answer to, if someone comes at you with something that you're not ready for, then you get stuck. So it's really about listening, being open, and again, just letting those ideas flow. Say yes. Yes and is a big thing when it comes to us having ideas and in the rehearsal process as well, simply because it propels you forward. I was going to do a little game, but it might take a little bit of time. Shall I?
Yeah!
Excellent! See, we've just started already. So basically, you have to say yes to every question that I ask. Is there a little girl standing at the top of the hill?
Yes.
Is she carrying a bucket?
Yes.
Is the bucket full of apples?
Yes.
Is she hungry?
Yes.
Is she eating, or is she taking and eating an apple?
Yes.
Is she enjoying the apple?
Yes.
Is she looking back into the bucket?
Yes.
Is she taking another apple?
Yes.
Is she rolling it down the hill?
Yes.
Can she see someone at the bottom of the hill?
Yes.
Have they grabbed that apple?
Yes.
Et cetera, et cetera. So we're creating this story, we're just rolling with it. So now, if you could just say no, that would be great. Can we make up a story together?
No.
Okay. Kind of obvious, but we forget that how yes and compared to no, it's kind of a big deal. And play the game. Yeah, so games have rules. And that gives you, within the perimeters, it just gives you freedom within those rules to do and play. So structure and then hang all the fun stuff off of that. Work's a treat. And lastly, relax and have fun. And wear sequins to work every now and again during the day. And there are basically, that's our improvisation of life. Thank you. Back to you, Ads.
So I want to kind of show you some examples of what it is we're talking about. Because I understand that it can sound floaty. It can sound unusual and strange. It's like, well, it all sounds rather idealistic. But what I want to show you is, moving into, for example, the commerce side of my very technical diagram, is that this kind of thing, if you're applying it to business objectives, gets results. So I'm going to show you a few examples. Some of them we made, some of them we didn't. Imagination is at the heart of this first one. I want to show you how giving one person the greatest day of their life can inspire enormous amounts of action from millions of people. This example is BatKid. Does anyone know what BatKid is? Has anyone heard of this?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is a charitable initiative. We didn't make it, I wish we did. run by the Make-A-Wish Foundation last year. The Make-A-Wish Foundation grants one wish for terminally ill children. I'm going to skip to the happy ending of this child's story because he actually recovered, and that's actually never happened to a Make-A-Wish child before. This kid wanted to be Batman. And the Make-A-Wish Foundation commissioned a little pot of PR money and started to reach out to people in the city of San Francisco. Can we make this kid Batkid? Can we get a guy dressed up as Batman? Can we put a Batman's... Can the Lamborghini garage down the road lend us a black car and we'll stick a Batman sticker on it? He can drive around for a bit. But then the city caught wind of this. The banks did, the government, the local government, I mean the mayor. And all of a sudden, they started opening up the city to facilitate this, essentially this game for this child. So the city bank opened its vaults and this kid captured the Riddler. He saved the mascot of the city's football team when it was tied to a train track. This is actually that day's San Francisco Chronicle. They changed their entire newspaper to serve this one narrative, this one boy having the most incredible day. This kid's imagination inspired 30,000 people to line the streets of San Francisco, just seeing him walk around in a silly costume. It's not a silly costume, actually, it's really cool. But it was this idea of harnessing the imagination to capture the imagination of others. They didn't need to take part to feel special. And if you look at what happened with this PR campaign, 700,000 tweets, 18 million shares, 1.2 billion page views, and in the bottom right-hand corner, if there are any media agencies in the house, it's the money bit, so you might want to look at that. £250 million in donations in 2013, up for nearly 400% on 2012. So basically, something like a £50,000 PR campaign generated $200 million for that charity. One little kid dressed as Batman did that because his imagination was captured and people felt inspired by that. Click, not working. Oh, there we go. This is something that we try and do, and it's a bit about what Natalie was saying about the improvisation of life. That's how you should feel when you get a new brief in the talk. Yes, come on. Because people see briefs as limiting. They shouldn't be. Think of it as if you're a dog and you've just been given a new chew toy. A dog, when you're given a chew toy, isn't sad because he can't chew the sofa anymore. He's like, yes, a new chew toy. That's what a brief is. It's a new creative space to explore. And I think we meet a lot of similar smaller companies, around about our size, and what they see a brief as is a set of rules they have to obey. And instead, yes, there are boundaries about what you can do, but it doesn't mean you can't push against them. You think of it like a playpen instead of a prison, and all of a sudden it becomes a lot more fun to deal with these briefs. Yes, and. That's what Natalie was saying before. So this culture of saying yes, and is what has transformed us from being purely a performance-led company into something else entirely. We still do immersive theatre projects and we sell tickets and we make money from those tickets, but we also do commissions for marketers and brands. And we also end up getting asked to do things that we never thought we could accomplish, but through collaboration and reaching out and going yes and then going home and crying when no one can see us, that's how we sort of grow. So I want to show you some examples of our work now. We work with Courvoisier. This is actually a couple of years ago now, so this is maybe probably the sixth or seventh project that we ever worked on, and we've now made over 60. Courvoisier came to us and wanted to do some kind of live experience for press, but also for consumers. And they had an interesting goal. People don't drink cognac in bars. They go home and they have a snifter of it in their drawing room, and they sit around with their books that smell like rich mahogany. They want people to walk into a bar and have a cocktail, so the bar's on Courvoisier. So initially, we needed to sell tickets to this event for the public. So we created this Master of Cognac character. He's a mysterious, shadowy head of an organization known as the Secret Institute of Cocktail Making, a timeless organization that preserves the knowledge of how to make cocktails. We brought him to life online, telling people about his institute and how the doors are going to open. And straight away, we had a lot of interaction generated through simply just social media. At this point, we hadn't spent a penny. We just took a few photos, dressed up my brother, and put a funny hat on him. But we were reaching out to these journalists and getting them intrigued in story. Then Courvoisier very kindly let us hijack their social media channels, and basically we started making it seem as if they'd been hacked. But they'd been hacked by this master of cognac who's upset that the world has forgotten about how to make a cocktail out of certain drinks. And then finally we ended it with a live execution, the live activation. So we created this institute, we created a Rococo ballroom, we created a spice market, we created two angry Frenchmen that can't agree on what makes a perfect grape. And we put about 500 people through this experience, which doesn't sound like a lot, but again, the results generated were quite interesting. So 500 attendees, we generated over 1,000 tweets with the desired hashtag. We received over 51 pieces of individual coverage. We increased Courvoisier's Twitter followers by 10% in 2 weeks. And as you can see, the engagement on their Facebook page well, as high as it's ever been. And we really didn't do an awful lot. We didn't spend any money on media. We didn't buy any ad space. We didn't do anything like that. We just talked to people. So often, the people that commission us are like, oh, you know, we really want to communicate with our customers, and, you know, what can we do with technology? What can we do with this? And then sometimes you just have to say, have you tried actually talking to them? And that's what we did here. And in a way, it was an incredibly personal experience. We asked people to bring customized fruit. One person didn't get the memo and bought a stuffed squirrel, but I'm not sure why. I'm going to start skipping through because I realize I'm running over already. So, technology. So this is the part where we started diverging from our original mission statement of making performance. So we worked to launch a zombie game, part of the Resident Evil series. This was where we were asked simply to create the zombie apocalypse. We essentially created a prequel to a computer game about zombies invading the world and eating people's brains. But in partnership with the Tom Sawyer Effect, we produced an app, a GPS-led app that would lead them through gameplay to various locations around London that we had then transformed into scenes from the game. The app was socially enabled. People could tweet as they go. They could play alternate reality games as they went using the camera on it. But again, at the heart of it all was real interaction with our actors, and through their actions they pushed this story forward, and the story that we told ended with the beginning of the game. There was also a digital element, so we had a fully narrative-led website where you could sign up for this experience. Again, all this is in character, it's, you know, placing you as the bad guy from the game. And we had some cool lasers, which was really good. But so we were allowed to use the IP. The company, Capcom, trusted us enough to use their intellectual property and adapt it for this live experience. Again, some great coverage, some interesting headlines, which I especially enjoyed that from City AM. We also made the technology journalist from the Sunday Times cry with fear. So that was a real career highlight for me. This is something where it was a project of two halves. We launched Hertz's second album, Exile. One was a kind of subversive, interactive PR campaign, essentially, which I'll take you through in a minute, where we started sending people physical things in the post, love letters. So this was purely for journalists. This was, we had to promote the themes of Hertz's new album, which is loneliness, anger, bitterness, sadness. And these are all things that journalists can relate to very strongly. There was this real kind of Eastern Bloc feel to the music. It was very stark. So we created a character called Valentina, who started communicating with these journalists in the post. So we started sending them love letters, tape recorders, and at one point we actually sent them a dry cleaning ticket that could be redeemed at their local dry cleaners. So while this is all going on, these journalists are writers. They don't even know what this is about yet. They probably think that they are actually being chatted up by a strange Russian. But they started writing stories about the story, and people started following it online. These are all comments before anyone even knows what this is about. And eventually, they went and redeemed those tickets at their local dry cleaner. What they got was a tuxedo with a golden tape inside. You put the tape into the tape bed and send 3 weeks before. And what they got was a snippet of the new album and an invite to a live event, which was a launch party. But what people were saying online was, this is awesome, but why did journalists get all the fun? And so we went, okay, well, how can we do that? How can we do a story, tell a story like we just told, for everyone? So we made an app. We made this with Foam London, an agency based, they actually work with, they used to be a part of Sony and now gone independent. And we created essentially a voice-controlled 3D binaural sound choose-your-own-adventure game. So you stick your headphones in, you close your eyes, and you let this 3D sound wash over you, and you talk to it. You meet these characters, and you're trying to escape from a cult, and you run, and it asks you, like, where should we go? Should we go to the basement or the kitchen? You say, I want to go in the kitchen. The scene continues. And what the effect of this was, it was a play with essentially 12 endings. Each ending was a sample of a different song from the album. So basically what the effect, the result of this story that was really quite fun was, is that we put 250,000 album samplers in people's hands by creating a game. And it didn't feel like a promotion. It didn't feel like an advertisement. What it was, and this is a key word in very many industries here, what it was content. It was something that was rewarding by itself that just so happened to be promoting something. The album went in straight at number 2, unfortunately, didn't quite get to number 1, but it was very different from their first album, so I'm not accepting the blame for that. We got some great responses from those that attended as well. It's something that people like because it's made for them, it's personal, and there's this idea of luxury, and luxury being expensive, I think, is a fallacy. I think luxury is a unique experience, it just happens that being able to afford something is what makes things unique to some people. I think something that's tailored to them is as luxurious as expensive.
So moving on from the case studies, and moving back to crossing over, there is a battle for the creative soul. By the way, we don't know who that is, we can't be friends. So those three areas, commerce, art, and entertainment, those are essentially represented by three masters for the creative. Commerce is the client, if you work in an industry where you are commissioned. Entertainment, the master there is your audience, who really is your boss, your true boss. And the art, which should be yourself. You should be making what makes you happy. So this is a client. You shouldn't see them this way. The client, much like I said about the breeze before, the client is not there to shut down your ideas. They are rooting for you. They are on your side. They want you to blow them away. But unfortunately, people look at them now because they are the people that sometimes have to say no, because that's their job. But if you work collaboratively with us, that's a really difficult word. If you work collaboratively with them, and you know, you set mutual goals, and you say at the beginning, look, okay, you know, we read the brief, it's cool, we're going to do that, but we've also got some ideas that are bigger that you might want to take a look at. They like that. They like having ideas beyond the scope of what they've told you. The audience. They are your true boss. When you make something, you may have met all the points in the brief, you may have made something that makes you happy as an artist, but then you've got to think, is this still entertaining? If you're making content, it has to be entertaining. It can't just be like, I've got all the objectives, and it looks pretty, and we've got a good director to do the video and all of that, but actually it's boring. You know, that's the worst thing ever. You've got to look at it from your audience's point of view. They are the hero in these stories. And lastly, the artist. The artist. The third thing, when you're crossing over in this way, is you have to look at it and think, you look at what you've produced, you look at what you've made, and you go, does this make me happy? Is this art? Am I going to look back on this and go, that made me proud? Or am I going to look back on it and go, wow, that sure met the brief? Because that's not a fun way of looking at your work. You know, no one looks back and goes, remember that time we met at least 7% of the bullet points in that brief? No one does that. Well, you know, that amazing thing where we attack people, the zombies. So you've got to marry those three things. You have three masters: audience, client, yourself. And you have to look at every piece of work you make and go, have I made each of these three people happy? Am I happy? Getting up and going, so this is our office, basically. It's just naturally dancing. Again, we've already seen it. This is actually what we do in our brainstorm sessions, and also it's, I believe the tune was Kanye West, Black Skin, and it's awesome. So this is how Natalie gets loose. This is how, what you did with Natalie is what Natalie does to get in her own creative space. I'm not like that, so I don't do it. Natalie gets up and dances around the office. I think watching Natalie dance gets me in my creative space. I think, you know, just sitting down and having a coffee gets me in my creative space. Dominic likes wearing ridiculous sunglasses. That makes him feel very comfortable and you know, ready to go. But I'm coming to the end now. I just want to give you what we try and tell our clients when we work. So we were asked to talk about crossing over, but also ourselves, which I think maybe we've done too much of. Art, when commissioned, is still bespoke. So, you know, if you work with us, you aren't hiring a musician, you are making music, you are commissioning an album, you're not hiring a pianist. Always, always, always appeal to your inner child. We love working with children as much as adults, even though, you know, they might not speak as good English as an adult, they are often the ones that get the adults to play more. And I think if people acted more like children, then they'd find themselves enjoying their life a lot more. We do storytelling, we try not to be jazz hands, we try not to force ourselves onto people. What we try and do is get them to explore. We put the story out there and maybe let them find us. We let them explore for themselves. Our characters, our story, the art of conversation. Just remembering that really, when you're making something, you're making it for a person, maybe you need to speak to them, is incredibly valuable. This is one of the larger casts we've worked with at the Olympic Park last year. So yes, the audience, again, above everything else, always think of them. Always think of who's consuming and creating. They are the people that are ultimately your boss. Try not to make your audience feel uncomfortable. you know,
explain why you want to use this picture.
I've always wanted to use that picture in the presentation. Unless it's for a very good reason. Unless your message, if there's a message in what you're doing, unless your message demands it. If you need to make your audience feel uncomfortable, maybe that's the best way of communicating. One of the biggest viral videos of last year was Kony about child soldiers. And it was an hour-long video. It made people enormously uncomfortable, but that didn't stop it from being shared 200 million times. If you allow
if what you're saying and what you're doing is worthwhile, you can make them uncomfortable, but you should start from a baseline of, let's not make them do anything they don't want to do initially. I mean, that guy actually, I think, is loving it, but that's just my thought. Because the story you're telling belongs to your audience. Again, I can't say it's enough, they must. Your people that consume our stuff, but the things that we make, people that listen, play, interact, people that tweet us, they're lost. And finally, have fun. Always enjoy it. Thank you very much.
How awesome was that? One of my favorite tweets is, pretend there's a math on your armpit. Things got wonderfully weird for the opening exercise at Creative Mornings. Yeah. I'm sure you have questions for these lovely people. Questions? Don't be shy. We always have to go through this thing, guys. Come on, we've talked about it. No? Questions? About a creative process, about, I don't know, philosophy. I'm a bit intimidated because I was like, oh my god, you're gonna ask me. I'm gonna walk around with this, then you can ask your question.
Hi. Do you ever feel people aren't ready yet for it when you throw it at them?
Is this one on the phone? Often people, we are very much aware that what we make isn't for everyone. What we try and do is when we make something, we try and build it in a way where just spectating is also fun, but the greatest reward is from taking part. So, yeah, some people aren't ready, some people, I think I mentioned before, we try not to be jazz hands, we try not to be like, acting in your face, like that. We try and present a story like threads that can be pulled off. And as you begin to unravel the story, maybe you'll get involved, maybe you won't, but I think that the idea is that the baseline for us is that you don't lose anything simply by knowing what we're making is happening. So if you tell a good enough story, enough people generally will get involved to make it worthwhile. But yes, I mean, you are right in that some people aren't ready, some people aren't into it, and that's fine. Some people don't like modernism, some people don't like cubism, some people don't like romantic comedies. Yeah, some people don't like romantic comedies. That's cool, we get it.
The reason I'm asking is because it's such a London thing, and whenever I go home and I talk about these things that are happening here with my friends, or my parents, or my aunt and uncle, and they don't understand. And maybe, have you experienced this in other, have you been working in other cities other than London? It's maybe a cultural thing, or an age thing.
I think it's something that you can, I think you have put in points of context that people understand. Yes, we have worked in other cities. We've worked in France, Barcelona, San Francisco.
In America.
We've travelled across the American Midwest, so, you know, hillbillies. And generally they will like it. I mean, if I were to say to you it's basically like a computer game, except you're not holding a controller, you're doing it, people go, oh, right, yeah, okay, that makes sense. And that's kind of what it can feel like. It's like designing a computer game system. I think maybe it's something that's harder for people to get their head around than a computer game, but 20 years ago people didn't play video games, really. You know, it's just one of those things, and it is quite a London thing, I think you're right, or at least it's a very hip, cool, creative, young thing. But if that's your audience, if that's who you want to do, if that's who it is that you're trying to make things for, then it's effective.
But it's also, culturally, yes, but also it's about us educating people, and not just, you know, 25 to 35s, but younger crew, older crew, various genres, whatever you work in. And for us also educating the more commercial sorts of companies, like we've done work with Diageo, and kind of opened up their minds to, you know, being a little bit more creative. So yeah, it's different cultural things, but it's all about us gently pushing boundaries and educating people. And yeah, thank you.
Hello, I'm really interested in how you talk about kind of subverting the process, and about you know, saying yes and being quite playful. And I wonder if you could tell us in terms of your audience, obviously you're trying to marshal them or corral them into playing a certain part, playing a certain role, but I wondered if there were any examples of the audience subverting them rather than being quite playful with the space that you provide them.
Wow, that's a very cool question. I don't know. I think often we design, I guess, fairly short, sharp experiences, but I think the Courvoisier event that I mentioned before, we asked quite a lot of the audience that day. You know, we designed an experience that they moved through, and we knew that they would see all these sort of tentpole moments, but they were in each area that we designed for them. There were six different areas there, including that ballroom, the spice market. There was a woman had to handle in a fruit stall. But we asked them all to bring a fruit that they personalized that represented them, and some of the things they did, we were thinking people would write Alan on an apple. You know, we thought that people might put their initials on a grape. But people came in and some of them carved pumpkins, some of them. I mean, I mentioned there was this one of the strangest women I've ever met, where she has two jobs. One is taxidermy, and the other one is tailoring the rodents. So those two things synergize quite well. So she bought a stuffed squirrel that she then made a little waistcoat for, that she then gave us. And I actually had to give it back to her because it would have taken her days. And I said, we can't accept this, I'm sorry. I thought that's a really nice example of giving someone an opportunity and then not just grabbing it, but like eating it alive. And that whole day, actually, I suppose as well, because it would have boosted then people like drink that. But it was the way that people engaged in that space. We had one scenario where this ballroom that I mentioned, it was a party that has been going on forever, an infinite party, with ballroom dancers, and people were just literally, and people were supposed to just kind of watch it. It was beautiful, and they wanted to interact with the air of people jumping in, grabbing the dancers, and spinning around the dance floor. These are people that came in, you know, in room one, you know, half an hour before, they're kind of like, what the hell is going on? And then 45 minutes later, they're whizzing our dancers around the dance floor. You know, our dancers are knackered at this point, so they're quite appreciative of someone else holding them up a little bit. But, you know, just spinning around and playing. And yeah, I think people do take the opportunity to play. And sometimes what we do isn't necessarily us forcing people to play. It's sometimes just going, it's okay to.
Yeah.
You kind of have permission to.
That's exactly what I was going to say. It's giving permission to play in this space. It's like, it's your playground. We've set it all up.
You see the levels of self-consciousness just drop in a linear, like in an exponential drop from the beginning to the end. They come in at first like, oh my god, and then by the end, they're very much being engaged.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, I just wonder, how do you make your presentations? For example, if you go like super serious, like, yeah, we're going to put some zombies in the street, blah, blah, blah. Or you dress up like a zombie and try to eat your friend's brain, or...
I'm sorry, I didn't actually hear the question.
Like, how do you do your presentations? Like, you go very serious, or you go like performance, you try to...
Oh, like, do you mean like in teaching?
Yeah, to the clients, yeah.
It's a combination. We have to be very measured. We're aware that what we do can be seen as floaty, I guess. One of the challenges, I suppose, is differentiating ourselves as a business from, for example, people painting in a basement as an art collective, because we are a business. So we have to some extent, present ourselves in a serious way, and we have to show that we understand the objectives of the people that we're presenting to. But at the same time, the whole objective of what we make is fun and enjoyment. So, kind of similar to the way that presentation went, in that, yeah, there's all this crazy fun stuff that's sometimes hilarious, sometimes funny, sometimes, you know, a whole range of emotions, but then at the end, it's got to be, but you'll get resolved.
Yeah, at the end, you know, the client, you say, like, they say no or whatever, but if you don't make them experience what you're saying, probably then they're not going to understand what the audience is going to do.
Absolutely. A good example is we worked for Symantec, who are very, very Fortune 100 software company, and they're in information security. They actually have like, they own north to tell you the antivirus software, and Symantec is actually people sitting there fighting off things like protecting governments. So very, very faceless, grey company, full of individuals. And what was really funny there was we went and they were so conservative in our presentation to them because we thought they were conservative. And then all of a sudden, 2 weeks later, they're actually literally asking us if we could please use two real FBI agents as interrogators in our piece of theatre. You know, and this guy Michael Yard, he was the VP of software development, he sounds like the most awful in the world. Really, he's he's a superhero, and what he does is he writes novels at his spare time. He goes home at 6 o'clock from his very, very difficult job and plays in a thrash metal band once he gets home. So, I think that was a learning experience for us. Yes, some corporations are boring, but they're full of interesting people. They have a corporate message. So we try and find a balance, like you said. We try not to be too aggressively... fluffy. We have to make, you know, we need them to understand that we are here to meet their objectives in certain ways. Our way is a very weird way, but it works. And that's the message you have to get across. But we don't turn up in costumes or anything like that. We present very much like a normal business. I love that. Like a normal business.
Great. One last question, guys, and then we'll be hanging out here, so you can definitely ask all your questions. Yes.
How do you make the transition from a CPA company to more marketing companies?
That's a great question. Two different things, two different ways, really. As I mentioned, my background is in marketing. I actually used to work for an innovation consultancy. So I used to deal with a lot of large brands. I used to listen to what it is they feel they lack when they do their marketing. Quite often what they're interested in at my old job is they want innovation, which is basically a new answer to a whole problem. But I also knew from talking to them that this kind of thing would appeal to them. Because, you know, like it or not, they're going to be running some sort of event, you know, campaign next year or so. But it's kind of become a boxing exercise for them. At the same time, I actually joined the company after it formed. At the same time, the girls we're moving in that direction anyway. Someone else that we've worked with. So when we first started, it was very much about tickets and forming a festival and pure entertainment. But then some people that we collaborated with at Winterfell Festival invited us to develop something for actually that zombie game, Resident Evil. And that was very much the client's a PR agency. And then the other client is the games company. And that was the first time really that we've done something with marketing objectives in mind. It was also my first project for the company. So, those two things diverging and realizing that it actually could be effective, but learning that through both doing it and then having experience of listening to what these clients are saying, basically going back to them and going, hey, this is very different now. Would you like to check this out? That kind of thing. But talking to them from a position of authority. It's the fact that we do this and we do it for a living. We know what the effect can be. Have you ever considered using it in this way? And it was almost accidental. It was, again, it's yes and I really talked about.
There's also Isabel, founding director, seeing a gap in a market where, yes, immersive theatre as an entertainment and then experiential marketing, but then this really sweet spot in the middle where we can be commissioned to make immersive theatre for a brand who has a story. Every brand has a story, so it's like, that was a really important thing. So that's, just to add to what Adam said as well, that's how it kind of came together. And then the more we dove in, it's like, oh my God, there's like endless stories to be told. So hence why we've worked with so many different sorts of people and companies and genres. So yeah, thank you. Good question.
Thank you. Guys, we're very happy to stop here. Guys, thank you so much for your energy.